memoir, personal nonfiction, except it's not about me. In fact, I'm not even one of the characters in the story. See, I've been working on it for a while now, and the right stories, they change you. They become part of you, and you're just not the same anymore. But this story's different. See, this story, when it becomes part of you, well, you become part of it. Maybe you've heard it before. There are some shepherds and an angel and a star that's new to the sky. There's a young woman and an innkeeper and eventually a baby named Jesus. I'm sure you've heard some of it before, but you've never heard it from me. I'm a bit of an amateur historian, but I made my profession as a doctor. My name is Luke, historian, physician, writer. And they all rely on the same type of skills: asking questions, observations, listening to people. I had this hunch that being a physician could take me anywhere, to the busiest town or a quiet farm, a grand palace or a dirt floor. You see, when we're sick, we're all the same. I discovered, though, not all are treated the same when they're sick. In fact, I found that where I saw someone's humanity, other people, they saw their status. And so I made it my business to treat patients who no one else would see. And that's where I ran into a patient who told me about another healer. A healer who would treat anyone who would come to him. My patient swore to me, this man, he would sit with lepers and cleanse them. He would rub the eyes of the blind and give them sight. He even took a young girl who died of a fever and brought her back to life. Miracles. Could any man truly do this? Now, it must be said, I never met Jesus in the face-to-face sense. As you probably know, he died at the hands of the Romans. After his death, his followers claimed that he rose from the dead. The claims about Jesus all over Israel were swirling, getting bigger, bigger, larger. Even after his death, they claimed that he was the Savior. They claimed him to be Messiah, Lord. They even said he was the Son of God. I kept my distance for a time. But the claims about Jesus, who he was, what he did and didn't do, it became difficult to ignore. Over the years, I ran into many of his followers and his critics. I finally decided I had to follow my instincts. I had to get the facts. Who is Jesus? This was an important decision. And so, like any other important decision, I set off. With a sense of caution, certainly, but urgency. And I found some of his followers in the town of Galilee. My medical training opened the door for me, and I found a people who were strangely kind. They were loving and patient, open to me, even though I wasn't one of them. It was odd, you see. It's like they knew what I was looking for, even before I did. And there was a woman who moved in that circle. She never really called attention to herself, but it was obvious that the others, well, they respected her. And so one day I asked one of her friends, "Who is she?" "Don't you know?" he said. "She's his mother." Like a moth to the flame, I was drawn to her. And so I decided I would introduce myself. It was a bit awkward. "Hi, my name's Luke." "The doctor?" she said. I couldn't tell if it was a compliment or not, but I said, "Yes, I've heard many stories about your son." I would love to hear them from you. So she raised an eyebrow at me, looked me up and down, and she patted the stool next to her. Come, Luke the doctor, sit. Yes, my name is Mary, and I was there when Herod was king of Judea. We sat for hours, and she told me story after story. At first, I was afraid to interrupt her, but then I asked, Mary, can I take some notes? Once I started taking notes, the questions, they just bubbled out of me, question after question. Finally, I worked up the courage and asked if I could write this down for a friend. For a friend, she said. Yes, for Theophilus, and for myself. You see, a writer writes because he must. We have a story to tell, a story that others need too. And so I wrote. And as I wrote, Mary looked at me, smiling, her gray hair framing her face beneath her shawl. It's a good story, isn't it? She said. Do you believe it? She asked. And the thing was, I did. For the first time, it came to life for me that night. And now here it is, the prologue to the story of Jesus Christ, according to me. In two quiet nowhere towns, two unknown women find that they are pregnant. A common situation, but not for either of them. The first, Elizabeth. She's an old woman with an old husband and no children to care for her in her aging years until an angel of the Lord appears to her, to her husband, Zechariah, the priest, and says to him, don't give up, not yet. You're going to have a son. He will be a prophet announcing the coming of the Messiah. Zechariah, well, he was not thrilled. In fact, when most wander in and out of God's story, when they step in front of the supernatural, well, their tendency is fear. That's what Zechariah felt. He was afraid. I think that's important. It wouldn't be truthful to say that day he received the message, he cried tears of joy, or that he finally was able to ask the question of the meaning of life. No, Zechariah was afraid, and even more concerning, he doubted. I mean, it had been 400 years since God directly spoke to the people. And so he waved the incense from his faith, and he said, if this is true, give me a sign. And Zechariah got one. He lost his ability to speak. Meanwhile, in Nazareth lived Mary, a young girl on the edge of adulthood, anxious to marry the carpenter of her dreams. Life for her is about to begin. And so it does. For the second time that year, an angel of the Lord is sent to a human, this time to Mary, with the seemingly impossible news that she too will conceive a child. Not with Joseph, not yet. Her firstborn would come directly from God himself. And this young girl, this young educated woman who the world thinks so little of, she shows up the priest. Because impossible or not, something inside of her stands up and says, okay, yes, I don't fully understand, but I believe. Let it be to me according to your word. I think in each of us, I think God buries the potential for us to say yes to something great. Of course, with God's help. And Mary, with God's help, summons that yes, and she lives it. Now, make no mistake, the woman I met 40 years later had seen a lot of life. She watched her child that she loved, she nursed, she held, she cared for, grow to become a man. who at times, honestly, was pretty difficult from a parental perspective. She had to say goodbye. She watched him die. She had her heart broken, but then healed. Because she could always find her way back. Even in the hard days, even in the hard years, she could always find her way back to those same words. I don't fully understand, but I believe. See, Mary had found as a young girl a promise that she could hold on to, not simply because she sensed new life growing within her, but she believed fiercely in a God who would do everything he said he would do, no matter how long ago he said he would do it. Some look at that and think, faith, hope like that is foolish. I know many have called it that, but I'm telling you, when you see it up close in a person's life, like I did with Mary, it humbles you. It's something that you can't fake. That joyful radiance cannot be faked. It comes from another world, and nothing in this world, nothing, it can cover it up. And so, a woman, old enough to be a grandmother, bears a son, and Zechariah the priest discovers that there's always room to be surprised by God. And an unmarried young girl conceives a child by the work of the Spirit in her, and her flustered fiancé discovers his own yes moment, that he too can be as brave as she. My question was, what now? What next? Now, we know when and where Jesus' birth took place, because everyone involved anchors it in the little town of Bethlehem. It was during the reign of Caesar Augustus. He was ruler of Rome. He was one of the most powerful and ruthless men in all the world. And it was during that time when he called his first census. Now, he thought that he was moving events and people according to his will and command. But don't you see it? His reign, his rule, his power, his empire will be upended by a king who comes not with an army, but as a baby, by a group of local shepherds who spread the message that he is no ordinary child. He's the promised one. He's the fulfillment of all the messianic hope. Okay. I'm getting ahead of myself. Bethlehem. Bethlehem is important in the lives of the Jewish people, because Bethlehem is the ancestral home of the former King David, who was born as a shepherd in the Judean hills. Joseph, Mary's fiancé, was of the descendant of David. So when Caesar calls his census, guess what? Mary and Joseph must come to Joseph's ancestral home, Bethlehem. And they do. At about the time in the pregnancy where you don't want to be riding on a donkey. They show up in town and it's crowded. And after a long day and flustered looking for a place to stay, knocking on doors, the only place they find is a dirt floor stable with animals in it. In that moment, it was hard to believe that God was with them. When the pregnancy began for Mary, she was simply terrified. When it ended, she was exhausted. She and Joseph sat holding this tiny divine miracle in amazement, with joy, with wonder. What glory, what grace. What now, they must have been thinking. I mean, the miracle is here. The pregnancy is over. But out on the hills just beyond. There were shepherds watching their flock by night. God was working on another part of the story, because in the tradition of David, those shepherds were keeping their flocks until an angel of the Lord appeared to them and said, "I bring you tidings, good tidings of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And the sky, it erupted with the sound of a multitude of angels praising God, saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth with whom he is pleased." As the light faded and it went dark, the shepherds, they looked at each other, staring wide-eyed. Did that happen for us? And they set off toward Bethlehem, breaking every sort of social convention that was in place, peering in windows at night, listening for the cry of a newborn child, until they found him, just as the angel had foretold, wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. They approached Mary and Joseph and shared about the angels, shared about their message. They confirmed what God had said to Mary and Joseph, that it was true. And together they rejoiced, because the story is true. On their way out of town, the shepherds grabbed anyone that would listen, anyone they could find to share the good news with them, because they knew it was true. God had come. The Savior is born. Now listen, it wasn't all high moments after this. Hard things were going to happen soon, and harder things later. Hard things happen to us. I think I see why we long to linger at the manger, or in the hills, or in that room where Mary says, "I believe." Because this story tells us about the God we're dealing with. It shows us how he sent his son the way he did. It teaches us that he's the God of peace, that he's the God of good news. He's the God of salvation. He's the God of the overlooked shepherds and the undervalued Mary. He's Emmanuel, God with us. Did you know that when Jesus was grown, he described himself as a doctor? One day, some hyper-religious Pharisees found Jesus eating with sinners, a very un-rabbi thing to be doing. And they were cross. They were upset. So they approached him and said, "Jesus, why do you do this?" And Jesus asked them a question. Who needs a doctor, the healthy or the sick? "I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." Like I said, I'm a doctor. Maybe you think you don't need a doctor, but if you have a body, you're not healthy, not completely. And none of us have perfect health. Jesus was saying that our souls have a sickness, that our souls are sick with evil. They're sin sick. The truth is, we're not okay. Sure, we probably don't murder, and we're not out stealing or starting wars, but we lie. We get angry in our heart. We covet. We manipulate people. We're crude. We're mean. It's like we're always taking steps away from who God designed us to be. Sickness, untreated, is serious. If it goes untreated, It'll lead to physical death. I know, I've seen it. Sin sickness is serious. Untreated, it will lead to eternal death. But I've come to believe that when we see Jesus for who he is, Christ, Lord, Savior, and believe, no evil and no sin get the last word in our life, because this story is true. And this story is still being told. And the ending, listen, the ending is going to be so good. Jesus, well, he grew. And Mary, she faded from the story. But all these things, she treasured them up in her heart. It's a good story, isn't it? It's the type of story you'd want to share with someone around the dinner table. The type of story you'd share at the bedside of a child or to someone who's suffering and sick. You know, I think people will write songs about this story. I know I will never tire of hearing it or repeating it. I am writing this down, so that on the dark days, we can lift our eyes toward the light that still shines, Jesus Christ, and we can draw comfort from this story. We can find shepherds who have just heard the best news of their life, and we can run alongside them in joy. We can kneel beside the cradle with a tiny, tired family who simply said yes to God. And we too can find our own yes moment. We can sit with an old woman who discovered that she too was loved and cherished by God, and know in Christ that we are loved in the same way. It's a good story, isn't it? Is there someone you wish could believe it? A friend? A family member? Is it you? This is the story I want to tell, because this is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about.